Hello, I'm Eric Snodgrass, and thank you for watching today's Ag Forecast brought to you by Nutrien Ag Solutions, your premier platform for real-time global insights. I'd like to take you back to something we left off with on Monday's video, and that's going to be a revisit here of the NDVI imagery. Remember, the cooler colors represent lower NDVI values and poor plant health, and the brighter colors they represent better plant health. The map you're looking at here is 2019. And what I'd like to do now is show you again what 2020 looked like. We can see that through parts of France, the difference between 19 and 20 is really showing up, but also some improvement in parts of Germany. Maybe we can better see this by looking over at the latest European Drought Observatory map, showing you where we see the drought conditions in France and parts of Western and Central Germany. So keeping in line with this understanding of what's been going on this summer in Germany and in France, let's now go a little bit farther to the east of there and talk about Ukraine. So there's Ukraine, and I went back and I did an analysis across Ukraine, which we can see from the Drought Observatory, they don't have drought. And I've been looking here over the last 180 days at their precipitation and temperature characteristics. After a cool April and May, June was warm, but then as we got into July and August, they've had regular weather patterns, bringing in some above average temperatures, but followed by cool downs. Overall, early in the season, things were dry, but getting through the month of June, precipitation really increased above average, and that lasted into early July. But over the last 30 days or so, they've kind of flattened out and headed back toward average. So while it's been a drier last 30 days, the time period leading up to that had adequate precipitation across much of the country. Now, as we think about the impact of this, remember this map. This is a corn production map, kind of by district here across Ukraine. And more than half of the corn crop is grown right in this area. So going back to those NDVI images, in 2019, remember, we're going to watch the difference between 19 and 20 right inside that area. So here's the map from 19, this time period, and here's 2020. And overall, as I go back to 19 and go to 2020, we do see that overall from space, the crop looks better here. Where it looks worse is farther to the south and over here in the Russian wheat belt. That's where we see the degradation compared to 2019. Now, keeping on this kind of international flavor here at the beginning of the video, I want to take you now to South America. We have seen in some of our latest satellite imagery quite a bit of smoke coming from fires in Brazil's main growing areas, but also coming out of the Amazon. Some of those fires extend into parts of Paraguay and southern Brazil as well. But I want to take those drawings off there and show you what we saw yesterday on satellite, which was this large area of cloud cover. Why it's important to notice that is that if you come to this animation, we can see that along that frontal boundary over the last week, there's been quite a bit of precipitation. See it here? And why I'm bringing this up to you is that right now, parts of southern Brazil, particularly Rio Grande do Sul, is allowed to plant full season corn at this point in the year. And so as we look forward in their forecast, while they're going to be drier in that area over the next 10 days, remember that the recent rainfall that came in is going to allow them to get that crop planted. But as far as I understand, I think it's only about 20% of Brazil's corn crop is a full season corn crop. Most of it is a second season or safrinha crop grown in Brazil's northern growing area. One thing to point out though, in southern Brazil, they're still dealing with some pretty chilly air. Over the next 24 hours, there's a pretty decent risk down in parts of Paraná, getting into Santa Catarina, and then down into Rio Grande do Sul, where they could still continue to have issues with frost. So we've got some cooler air there as well, which could delay that. And speaking of delays, the latest European weeklies, which were released on Monday evening, well, they picked up on that heavier rainfall we just saw, but notice that through the month of September and October, they're keeping this region, Mato Grosso specifically, drier than average. In fact, much of Brazil's northern and eastern growing areas drier than average, which could delay the planting of soybeans. Remember, they have to wait until they get that first those first good rains to really go after aggressive planting. So we're seeing the drier conditions last there, and this could be significant for the start of the growing season in South America. From there, I'd like to take you to a quick update on what we've been talking about with La Nina. Some adjustments. The MJO appears to not want to get stuck right over here in this part of the Indian Ocean, Africa. It looks as though it's going to move. That means we could continue to see this pocket here of cooler temperatures stay cool, which is going to give a bit more life to our La Nina moving forward. That's an update from Monday. And next, do notice how warm conditions are here in this part of the Atlantic, Caribbean, and Gulf of Mexico, which is an area we're watching very carefully right now. We have three separate regions we're watching. Let's just go west to east. Invest 97 out. We're going to watch this open wave move toward the Yucatan Peninsula and potentially interact here in the Gulf of Mexico. Behind that is Tropical Depression 13, which yesterday produced some pretty well-defined convection, and early this morning still trying to do that. And then there's another wave that's coming off of Africa we're going to watch very carefully as well. All three of them here in the main development region right now moving into a climatologically favorable time of year to get a lot of cyclone development. So let's take a look at what the National Hurricane Center is watching for here. And with 97L, the system that's out ahead, they've given it an 80% chance of developing into a tropical cyclone, so becoming a depression. We have seen the upgrade to Tropical Depression 13 here, and they're currently giving this a 40% chance of developing over the next 5 days. Now, as I look out just into the day tomorrow, a couple of things I notice. The lead wave here, 97L, doesn't fully close off of circulation. So as it moves toward the Yucatan Peninsula, its speed and the background wind shear will determine if this system strengthens before it gets to the Yucatan. But some models, and you'll see this in a few moments, do want to bring what's left of 97L into the Gulf of Mexico, where ocean temperatures are warm. What will be problematic for 97L in here for rapidly strengthening will be a deeper trough that could possibly keep wind shear high and limit this system. Going back to Tropical Depression 13, as it approaches the Lesser Antilles, which are right in through here, we still see an open wave. And given that the high pressure cell to the north of it will likely increase wind shear on the northern side, while steering it toward Florida here, it will likely not be able to intensify quickly over the coming days. So if we just take a look at some of our model guidance here for Tropical Depression 13, it is clear that maybe over the next 5 to 7 days, what's left of it could be moving toward Florida. It is too early to accurately speculate on the strength of this system, given its track and the wind shear that is to the north, but I do believe that the steering currents do have this right for taking it toward Florida and potentially the Gulf Coast. And when it comes to 97L, this is where the model spread becomes quite large. You go out to day 5 and look, this is how wide the spread is in the models here on where this might possibly end up. We'll watch it carefully should it get into the Gulf of Mexico early next week for bringing increased chances of precipitation and possibly some stronger winds here to the Gulf Coast. But at this point, again, given what the system has been doing over the last 48 hours, there's a lot of uncertainty. And remember, it still has to go over the Yucatan Peninsula before it can get out into the Gulf of Mexico. So I want to keep you aware of what's going on in the tropics here. One last tropical update to give you. This satellite animation shows you Genevieve, which was a pretty powerful tropical cyclone just off the tip of the Baja. Why we're watching that carefully is, well, just like with Tropical Storm Elita, take a look at the forecast model tracks of Genevieve. You can see that the remnants of Genevieve could come up here and introduce quite a bit of higher moisture content into parts of Central California. Now, as you're looking at this, please don't get hung up on the fact that some of the models are taking what's left of Genevieve, you know, clear to Manitoba and through Ontario. Do not start to think about this and freak out. Nope, it's just one model run doing that. The majority of them take what will be left of the weakening system of Genevieve toward California, though. And I want to keep a close eye on that as it introduces quite a bit of moisture there, maybe in the 5 to 7 day time period. From there, let's go ahead and take a look at yesterday's satellite animation. I'm sure your eyes are drawn to what you see over here in the western United States as we go into the overnight hours here. Watching this animation start again, we can see the convection running around that upper level ridge, which is literally parked right on the four corners. And you see the smoke that is in the fires there before we transition into the infrared imagery overnight. You can see, look at the poor air quality in California, but watch right into this area again as we get the infrared imagery. You can see those lightning-induced fires there showing up as those bright black spots, which tell me that the temperatures are very high, that we're picking them up on satellite. Meanwhile, we'll continue to see storms cascading around this ridge that will go through parts of the Canadian prairies into the Dakotas, northern Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, and a permanent feature, I think, in this forecast through the next 7+ days will be just daily convective events kind of trapped there from the Delta into the lower Mississippi River Valley on the western side, and then the Tennessee and Ohio Valley on the northern side. So everywhere to the southeast of those two areas, we're going to see a lot of storms. In between, relatively drier conditions overall, but we could get some storms into the western corn belt, and I'll show you those in a few moments. But quickly here, take a look at the air quality issues we're having in the western United States. This was just a snapshot from our high-resolution satellites yesterday showing the smoke in California, Nevada, but also in parts of Colorado and New Mexico. From there, I would like to show you an animation over the next 18 hours of vertically integrated smoke, continuing to show that smoke really trapped in that upper level ridge. So major air quality issues across the western United States with these ongoing fires. What's keeping it all there? This large ridge. And our big question in this video is going to be, are the troughs that keep coming out of north of the Aleutian Islands into the Gulf of Alaska and then running through the Canadian prairies, are they going to be enough to flatten and move that ridge out of the way? Does the North Pacific stay unblocked enough that we can continue to keep these weather systems moving rather than getting permanently stuck into this configuration? Let's get to those answers. First, later today, the good news is I don't see through parts of California, Oregon, Nevada, Washington, a lot of lightning activity, which means the chances of starting new fires has been reduced in terms of lightning activity. Where we see those storms? Well, we can see them here in the Canadian prairies. And by the way, this map you're looking at is this evening, looking at lightning flash density. We can see storms running around the periphery of that ridge, getting into parts of Montana, Wyoming, and the Dakotas, and then coming around the backside of it here through parts of Arizona. And also, as we said, the southeast, quite a bit of thunderstorm activity moving forward. And we're going to talk about some storm chances in the western corn belt here in just a few moments. Over the next 3 days, I got the Storm Prediction Center's outlooks across the top. So we go up there Thursday, Friday, and Saturday from left to right. And as I animate the image on the bottom, you can see where those storms are really flowing through that flow that I showed you a few moments ago. With the larger ridge wrapping storms around it like this, storms kind of cascading over the northern side of it, going into parts of the northern plains, getting into the Great Lakes states, the daily convection that's over the southeast. Watch it all again. Ready? That's what we're watching for the next 3 days here. By the time we get to the end of this animation, we could increase our precipitation chances in the western corn belt. Let's talk about that here by taking a look at the National Weather Service's forecast here for the next 7 days of precip. So it's the same story. You can see in the western part of the United States, the daily convective activity running around the ridge, the storms that are going to continue to pop here in the southeast, and then look right up here through parts of Ontario getting over into Quebec, but also clipping this section of the Dakotas getting into the Great Lakes states here, we are seeing better chances of some heavier rainfall. But notice by the time we get toward the end of this weekend, or the end of this week, end of the weekend, there will be a weak frontal boundary that could be bringing in some precip into southern Minnesota and Iowa. And we see that also in the European model. See it right in through here? Almost everything else looks very similar. Southern Saskatchewan, Alberta, dry, but as you see, the storms run around the periphery through this part of Ontario over into Quebec. The storms here, and look, the European model wants to take what's left of 97L and pull it up there toward the Louisiana and Texas border. So let's take a quick look at that by going to the operational European model. Playing this forward, we can see the pieces coming together we just discussed over the next few days. You see the daily storms popping down here, higher pressure tucked between that, and the weak frontal boundary that by the time we get through the day on Friday, watch it here in a few moments, will be coming through this section of the Corn Belt and through Minnesota. So here it is, Friday morning, afternoon, and evening. So that's the one that might increase our storm chances here, and it'll show up again in the day on Saturday. So this is Saturday morning, afternoon, and evening. So you can see it right in through there, scattered storms. But still, stretching here over the southeast up toward the eastern Corn Belt, possibly getting through the Ohio Valley, better chances of storms in there. But in the middle, right in through here, it will have to wait until we get through next week. So look, I'm now to Monday morning, afternoon, and evening, where we start to see what could be left over from 97L coming here into the Gulf. But to the north of it, there will be a frontal boundary finally squeezing through here by the time we go from Tuesday night into Wednesday morning, afternoon, and evening. There you go. Start to see it showing up there as what could be left over from 97L brings some precip here into Texas and into Louisiana. From there, though, I want to show you where this pattern is heading. Day 10, GFS left, European on the right. Similar features are showing up, and the most important of which is this trough. Now, their timing's a little bit different. There is still an upstream ridge in both models, but what happens here is that the big ridge in the models is gone. It's flattened out. It's moved. And the models are keeping a relatively broader trough over the eastern part of North America. Going from day 10 out to day 15, though, this is where the models really begin to separate. They both tend to feature the very active North Pacific putting that trough north of the Aleutian Islands and some sort of a ridge here. But notice that the GFS brings the trough there, a broader ridge stretching from New Mexico clear over to Georgia. And the European says, nope, let's bring this deeper trough through, kicking off a lot of storm activity on the downstream side of that. Okay, we're really on the downsloping side of it, I guess you could call it. So what does all that translate into? It translates into this. The GFS paints this corridor wet, but tries to keep things drier where that broader ridge is going to set up. The European opens everything up and keeps a very stormy pattern as we finish the month of August and go into the month of September. So these model differences out at the end of week two is something we're going to have to watch very carefully. From there, I want to point out one feature though. All of our major modeling centers do not slow down the Pacific jet stream as we move forward, which means the North Pacific is going to continue to remain unblocked. And that means downstream of it, which is here in the United States and the Canadian prairies, I do believe will stay unblocked as well. And that is good. We don't want blocked weather systems to finish a growing season. So finally, let's talk temperatures. As we play out over the next few days, the models have come into much better alignment and the National Digital Forecast Database has adjusted as well, seeing the cool down in the Pacific Northwest first, the cooler air remaining in this area, but watch the warmth spreading here into the northern plains and then over into the Great Lakes states as I go from Thursday into Friday here and then into the weekend. So now you can start to see much better agreement in the models and through this area, bringing those upper 80s and lower 90s back into place. Pacific Northwest goes back over normal, and we start to calm down those temperatures in California, but still hot under the ridge in the Intermountain West. Going from Saturday into Sunday, and now into Monday, a warmer start to next week here in this part of the Corn Belt. But like I showed you, there's another front coming through middle of next week. So this warm up here is not long lived, and it's just getting up into the upper 80s and lower 90s. So here's Tuesday getting into Wednesday, and there's that cooler air starting to show up. To go from there just fully into that 6 to 10 day time period, remember the warm up starts first here. You can see it showing up in both models. But as we saw, there's a cooler shot of air that will be coming into this region middle of next week, starting at about this day 7 time period here. So if we look out longer than that, this is the 11 to 15 day outlook. Remember, the GFS trough with a broader ridge underneath. What's the European doing? The ridge is out west, much broader trough in through here. And that's what kept this whole corridor stormier. So at this point, the day 11 through 15 forecast, if I was sitting right here in the central part of the United States, we can see dramatic differences in the forecast. Which model will have this right? I honestly, at this point, can make a case for why each is right. And it all depends on what happens in the upstream flow over the North Pacific. So we'll watch it, we'll analyze it, and report back to you very soon. But thank you for giving me your attention this week. I hope you all have a great finish to yours. Have a good one. Thanks.